Gospel of John, first chapter. We're going to look at verse 1. You're here, you're mental factor to me is a spiritual factor. It affects my spirit, so I don't care if my mind doesn't comprehend God. My spirit knows that He's real. And I've had people say, well, you can't convince me. I said, you're right, I can't convince you, nor will I try. I can only tell you that He is real just because your mind cannot grasp that. You know, God makes your mind, by the way. And your mind is part of your soul, and it does not have the capacity. It does not have the capacity. Your mind doesn't have the capacity to grasp God. But God made you a spiritual being until you're born again. Meaning your spirit is regenerated. Until that takes place, there's not enough words in the world to convince you. There's not enough arguments. There is only the reality. The word. The reality. Now, because our minds, you know, I'm jumping ahead just a little bit, but because our minds cannot comprehend the fullness of Him, and our spirit has to be brought into that fullness of the reality, it is significant that the Word or the Bible be, first of all, introduced to our minds. We'll get into that more and more. But the Bible is not truly the Word. The Bible is the Scripture. You should never forget that. The Word was with God, for the Word was God. So the Word is there in the beginning. For you and I to comprehend the beginning, you must be there, or you must be there in the Word. In the Word. Now, it's interesting that before creation, verse 3, there is a beginning, but it doesn't really give you a lot of explanation except with the word "the." So the only explanation it gives you is Word and God. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. There is no explanation of beginning except with the article "the." There is no explanation. You cannot comprehend it. Unless you bring into the understanding of beginning as God knows it, the Word. The Word. Okay. So, for right now, we'll say this as the Word, because this is where we receive the Word of God. Okay. And this is the place where you begin. I know a lot of people who got saved, they received the Lord, they got saved, but they continue to live their life based on their beginning. Based on their beginning. Either when they were born in some hospital somewhere or when they got saved. That was their beginning in the Lord. And so they live for God based on their beginning, not based on God's beginning. Okay? You know why? Because they haven't been founded in the Word. The Word is first, or in the beginning. The Word is first, or in the beginning. You have people say, oh, brother, we ought to praise the Lord. We ought to praise the Lord. You know, praise will do a lot of stuff. Well, okay, let's say praise will do a lot of stuff. But in the beginning was not praise. In the beginning was the Word. And people say, oh, prayer. Prayer is the key to all things. Prayer will do anything. Prayer changes things. But not in the beginning prayer. In the beginning was the Word. Right? You know, I know a lot of people who, you know, get concerned, and so they go to prayer. First of all, the Word was God. The Word was God. So I'm going to go to God. Anybody ever say, anybody ever say, well, they're going to go to prayer, I'm going to go to God. But the Word was God. To go to the Word is to more clearly be able to know, to hear from, and to find direction from the Lord. So So, let me read just a little bit. When you go back to the beginning, there's nothing but the Word. In other words, you start cutting everything out of your life, this factor, that factor. You go all the way back to the beginning, there's nothing but the Word. In the beginning, there was just the Word. Good foundation. Good foundation. What we do is we get saved. We don't go back to that beginning. We start at our beginning when we get saved. And we have an experience. And so we start basing everything on that experience. That experience was really good. I got saved. I got healed. I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. And we go back to that. We relate everything to that. And so we relate, was this a good church service based on the good church services that we had? You understand what I'm saying? They're all our little beginnings. But we don't go back to the Word. To the Word. And I believe one of the things that's made our church services different is, you know, the Word is a constant. The Word of God has got to be the constant. The prayer services may be up or down or different, or, you know, the prayer meetings may be this and that, but the Word has got to be a constant. The Word has got to be a constant. Because if the Word is, then when you're emotionally down or you're emotionally up, or you emotionally don't feel anything, you have something that is stable. Some people don't think prayer is worth anything unless there's the kind of, oh, Lord, oh, 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 oh. You know. And, you know, that means that God doesn't really hear you unless you've got your eyes closed real tight and there's a vibration in your throat. It is that added thing that you have brought that brings you closer to God. I thought faith did. I thought faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please. But we're going to add that in. We're going to say, this is going to, you know, okay. Oh, Lord, you know, but we're not praying in faith. So we say, okay, I realize the last 5 times I prayed, God didn't answer because I wasn't, you know, really in tune. So now I'm going to get in tune. Really, oh, instead of just going. You are constant. You are faithful. You never change. You are the foundation. And based on your word, I pray. Based on your word, I praise. Based on your word, I minister. Because in the beginning was the word. There are a lot of people ministering who aren't ministering based on the Word. A lot of people praying who aren't praying based on the Word. So they don't have a proper beginning. They don't have a proper beginning. They haven't started yet. Not in the right place. And you know, you do know that if you start in the wrong place, you usually have to go back to the beginning. I always said, I remember this from early, and I don't know if I heard it somewhere or what, but I always, this little phrase was always stuck in my head. If you start wrong again, you say, well, can you start wrong, go back to the beginning and right? Yeah, that's because you started wrong, then you started right. You ever heard this saying, you can't get there from here? Well, you can't get there from starting wrong, but you can get everywhere from starting right. And so, you know, I have encouraged people to be in the Word, to know the Scriptures, to know the Word of God, to know the Scriptures, to study the Scriptures, study, 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 because there will come a time when the Holy Spirit will make that life to you. But right now, it's not knowing the Word, really it's knowing the Scriptures. But that's necessary at first. The Holy Spirit is like, I was thinking, I'm learning lead guitar. And, you know, part of learning guitar, piano, or anything else, you learn these scales, you know. And I was thinking, before I never knew scales. And, you know, 2 years ago or 3 years ago when the Great Rock Band was gone, before Brian came, I was playing lead and rhythm. I played lead. I played all kind of lead and stuff like that. But all of a sudden, now I'm learning these scales, and all of a sudden I'll stop, and I'll just start picking up here, or I'll pick up here, or I'll pick over here, or I'll pick. And I realize that I've got way more versatility because I know where all the right notes are on the neck. You know, before I would learn a lead, put it right here, but I didn't really learn anything with that lead. I didn't learn anything to build on. I learned a few notes in a certain order, and I had to memorize that. That would mean every lead I ever played, I've got to memorize certain notes in a certain order for that. But to learn all the notes means I can pick, play, do, play around, be. Here's what I thought. I thought, I have a lot of creativity. But if I only know three notes, there's only so much creativity you can pack into three notes. Do you understand what I'm saying? There's only so much creativity you can pack in. But what if I knew all the notes and where they're all in location? The potential for my creativity is tremendous. Okay, what if you only know three scriptures? What if you only know a couple of books of the Bible? But what if you know as much as you can of the scriptures? The potential for the creativity of the Holy Spirit. And I've heard people say, I'll share something, they say, Randy, how'd you get that out of there? How'd you get all that out of there? You know, you must be just blessed and anointed. You know, well, we were sharing on the word in. And I took you over to Matthew 13 and I said, I noticed here that some seed fell by, and some seed fell among, and some seed fell upon, but some seed fell in. Well, when I was looking at the word in, you know, let's say I'm 3 months old in the Lord, I don't know anything but John 1:1, you know, in the beginning. I didn't read in the beginning and the Holy Spirit go, in, go over to Matthew 13. I know you've never read it before in your life, but there's some good stuff there. He doesn't do that. Every once in a while he might do something like that, but mostly he doesn't do that. What he does is while you're searching the scripture, he ties this with this, this, this. And then, when it's all in your spirit, you know, he starts bringing it all together, and then there's all this stuff that comes out, and you go, man, you know, but if you only know three scriptures, and you're waiting, well, I'm waiting for the big hand of God to hit me so that he'll just open the Word of God to me. Well, he can't open it. He can't open it until you open it. He can't open it until you open it. He can't spiritually open your eyes till you've got all the notes and all the things, and then he can take you up here, or he can take you over here, or he can take you right here, or he can take you over here. He can take you anywhere. He's got a variety of places that he can take you to show you stuff. But if you only know three notes, if you only know that he can take you here, and then he goes, well, you know, of course, I really can't take you even there because I've showed you the last five things out of those three notes, you know, those three scriptures. And you've already relegated your understanding in those three. These scriptures mean this. So I can't even open your eyes to these scriptures anymore because you're blocked to the ones that you know already. You've already figured it out. Have you ever done that before? I have done that. I have. That's why I like getting new Bibles every once in a while. Because I remember, I'll never forget it. One time I was preaching, I opened my Bible, and I had all these notes everywhere, man. I mean, notes. And I looked down, and I started sharing, and I just basically shared my notes. And then I realized, you know, I already know what I think these scriptures say. What if they said more than what I understand? I'm not going to know it because I've already got them locked in. As I was saying, we were talking about laying a foundation. I remember, I don't know how many of you know, but on the way out to the airport, there used to be, on the left-hand side on the way out there, this building that had all these different levels and walls, and it was all this weird shape. Some maniac put it together. And me and Deb stopped and talked to the guy. And I said, how the heck is this place going to be? I mean, it was like really weird, you know. And they were like, you could tell that there were stairwells that went up to nowhere and all this kind of stuff. And he said, well, I just started building, and this is the way I ended up. In fact, I'm still building on it. Of course, he's going, you know, that's kind of the way some of us are building our Christian life, to be honest with you. We're picking up pieces as we go and slapping them together, not realizing that there's actually an order to this thing, and we are wise to to go with God's order and to figure out what that is. And that's why, you know, there's certain basic scriptures. In the beginning was the Word. Seek first the kingdom of God. You see, those scriptures start setting priorities, don't they? Beginning, first, see? And we don't, you know, our first and our beginning is what we begin with and what we run across first. But you see, that's not God's first. That's not God's beginning. With time, we begin to get into this thing and we realize God has a priority. God has a plan. God has, this is before this. So this is not as important. Now, we would say of this, but this is important. But you say, ah, but this is not laid yet, so it is not more important than this. So I must concentrate on this for a while. Back to the guitar playing and stuff, but that's one of the things I'm doing right now is I'm working positive, working negative, working positive to learn the basics and to stick with the basics on the lead so that I don't mess up so that later on it'll be easy. I'm working not to run ahead without getting this in me, laying a foundation in me so that it is part of me, not just something that years later I wonder, how did that go? Or I wish I had really figured that out. So, but it's taking time. It's taking effort. It's taking reins. You know what I mean? On a horse, to pull back, to say, no, don't rush ahead. First of all, it may be more fun to get into that right now, but you're not really learning anything because you're going to forget that because there's nothing you're laying that on. And so, right now, be disciplined. Okay. Now, how many of us honestly don't like the word discipline? See, most of us got it. Okay. I admit it. I ain't crazy about it either. You say, well, you're supposed to be because you're an older guy. You're supposed to like the word. You know, well, I never grew up, so I don't. Okay. I have to admit, I don't like it. But now that I understand discipline and the value of it, I like it from God's perspective. I see, not just for me, but for others, the importance of it. Okay. Sure.
Yeah, I just recently, Lord basically showed me the same thing, but I have a lot of things that are just floating around that I really don't have an understanding how they connect. And showed me that I need to go back to the start of the beginning. And Hebrews 6:1 is talking about first principles.
First principles.
Going back. Not laying again the foundation. Well, the foundation has been laid. That's what I'm doing now, basically going back down to the beginning. I'm just trying to understand what justification is, trying to understand what all the basic principles are that are taking time to build upon. And maybe I haven't started at the very beginning, but I'm trying to start out some foundational beginning.
I think another way of looking at this like a farmer, and you consider that a farmer, we of course already studied Matthew 13, and it's funny that it uses different words there, by, among, upon, and in. But one of the seeds springs up immediately. And I don't know about you, but I think there's a lot of people that like the concept of, one day not playing lead and then one day walking in and going and everybody goes, whoa! I think some of us like that concept. The problem with that is that it's not realistic, or if whatever you've got isn't really, really that good, you usually end up limiting yourself and never really get much beyond what you first sprang up and showed off. Yeah. Whereas there is this slow process of going, I am going to have a harvest. What are you digging down in the ground for? You don't even have your seeds in. I'd be getting seeds over here and watering them and, you know, fanning them or doing them, whatever, because I want to make sure that the rocks that are deep down are pulled up so that
when it goes down, it can get deep roots. See what I'm saying? And so you're taking so long. It's taking so long the way you're going about it. Okay. It seems long when you're in that part of the process. But one thing that everybody, once you're past that and the harvest starts coming up, which is a way while later, people are always going, well, why are you so blessed? Or why, you know what I mean? I mean, because you've got so much into it that's going to come up. We are just not disciplined enough. We want to have this spring up, this little tree, and then this little tree, and this little tree. And then we get, 10 years down the road, and we've got a whole lot of little things that sprang up at one time or another, but the sun scorched them, and they had faded. And you look back, and you say, I have no foundation. I have no harvest. I have no... Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, it's like my first couple of years of my walk with the Lord, I felt like was that, the newest truth. I wanted to get hold of something new, something that was exciting for about 2 weeks. And then when that was gone, I was wanting something else. Oh, I was jonesing, man. I gotta have something else, man. I gotta have something cool, But I look back and I don't remember any of that. But I tell you what, these principles, I not only remember, they have become a part of me. They're how I operate. That's important. Kelly, did you have a comment?
Well, I was just thinking, the music stuff. I had that physical looking at me, and you sound better, and you look better than everybody else. But you lose it all. You don't even know what you were doing when you were doing it, because there was no foundation laid first. And I mean, like you said, with the Lord too, or anything else, that you look better for a season, but when the storm comes, it happens. It's not stable.
Right.
And the truth, it wasn't the true growth.
That's probably the best way to put it. Or it was true, but short-lived. It immediately, the Word of God says there, it immediately sprang up. But it withered because it had no depth. Jesus said that. Anybody ever see the movie Being Man? Peter Sellers. That is one of my favorites of all time movies. It's just so cool. It was just, one day we ought to get that. We ought to have that as a class. But the guy, and Peter Sellers is the gardener. He's not his usual totally saint himself. He's a very out of character. He's the gardener. And the president of the United States is there. And the president, I can't remember exactly how I'm told, but somehow the president ends up talking to him. And doesn't realize at first he's the gardener. And he goes, what do you think about the economic situation of the world? And he goes, he's just a gardener. He goes, and he ain't even thinking of that. He only knows gardening. He goes, if you plant seeds, then you get what you plant. Yeah, it's a little slow. And the president goes, wow! And the whole movie is based on this gardener that just, he just says these normal, common sense kind of things, and everybody's going, oh, and they're taken aback with how profound this is, the basic principles of life are there. And we've left those for trying to come up with philosophies and stuff that aren't basic, that have no real reality to them. And that's why true Christianity is wonderful, because it has a true basis that you can build on. Did I see another hand? Somebody else have a comment? Okay, so in the beginning was the Word. If we don't understand from the beginning, meaning that the Word is that beginning, then we will miss all the way down. If we start wrong, then we shall end wrong. To correct the problem, we must start back at the beginning. And that's why I think it uses the word beginning. It didn't say, on the onset, you must go back to the beginning, and the beginning is the Word. Okay, now, if we said to know the Scriptures is important, imagine how many years it might take to really get the Scriptures in, where you could somebody could basically say, well, tell me something about Philemon. Okay, well, I don't know everything, but I'll tell you about Philemon, Philemon's of this and that, and that. Okay, well, tell me something about Leviticus, okay? Leviticus is basically this, you see what I mean? How long would it take to be able to get, you know, not that you know everything in those books, you know what I'm saying, but I'm saying a basic feel for the Word, for the Bible. How long would it take? Well, maybe it might take years. It might take years. But think of all the hard work, if it was a concerted effort to really, really know that, and the concerted effort for years to really lay that foundation. Think of what God can do with the years after that with your life. Because now you have a basic foundation. He can draw from all kinds of areas and things.
It's not like God waits to you for a whole lot of work shows anything. Because you don't.
Right.
Because I, you know, when I was going to walk, I thought, well, I didn't know anything about the Bible, so that meant, you know, try to learn the Bible before I was, you know, Jesus. But, I mean, as you learn that first, let's say, you know, tackle a relationship with, like, Colossians or whatever, you know, Lord, you'd be able to, you know, and each time you search a new book out and learn it, that brings just that much more depth to what you call it. So
right.
I'm saying that the book, you know, lots of levels of learning.
Now, imagine somebody that says, well, I want to be, I want to work with you with all my life. This is what I want to do. And so they're sitting there and they're going, well, what is the point of a study of Colossians? You know, why would I study Colossians? I want to deal with you. I should go, like, get youth material. I should go to a Bible school where they emphasize how, you know, kids are down, you know, and you go over and put your arm around them and you say, come on there, pal, little buddy. You know, and because I want to deal, because I want to deal with you. And this is so dumb to be sitting in class talking about Colossians when this hasn't got nothing to do with what I want to do. You know, there are people that think that way, Greg. So the deal is that let's say somebody says, well, you know, I'd really like to be a counselor, maybe not in an official capacity, but maybe just a good, solid Christian that I can be there for people, I can talk with people and whatever. And then I say, okay, well, I need to go to so-and-so Bible school because they have a strong emphasis on counseling and whatever. Let me tell you, I know people that have graduated from major universities that have degrees, master's degrees and stuff, and they talk with people, and I've had, and this isn't anything other than what I believe the Lord, but I've had people that have gone to them and come to me and sat down in two sessions and said, you've helped me more in two sessions than all this junk. Now, don't let that totally say that anybody that's got a master's degree can't be used of God or isn't, because there are people that are. So that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, lay a foundation of a relationship with the Lord through His Word. And anybody that's truly effective, the one thing that you'll think about is, you know, I think they really know the Lord. Isn't that the truth? It's not, man, you know, I think that they're really going to help me because, look, they've got five plaques on the wall. Yeah. That's not going to help you. And all this stuff that you learn, I know people do this stuff, and they'll say, somebody walk in and they'll go, well, I have this and this and this problem, and they'll start talking and they won't even be in the same backyard, you know, and then when you're a kid and say, okay, we're all going to get together and play and we're going to meet in so-and-so's backyard, you know, well, that's how you knew how it was, you know, and somebody stop, you know, they're over here three houses down talking and everybody else is over here, and you're going, you're in the wrong yard, you're not even in my backyard here, you know. Well, people talk that way. You're going, I don't think you really have a clue. But they're using words like socially meaningful. You know what I mean? And you're going, hello, are you in there? You know? And you get a feeling that they don't even have a clue of where you're coming from. Well, let me tell you, you can have two kinds. You can have good kinds. You can have somebody that knows where you're coming from because they've been there. You know what? You can't possibly be where everybody has been. So the only other answer is the Lord. You know? I mean, to be where to other people, man, you had the privilege of, to be able to relate. Yeah. You know, and there are a few of us like that. I mean, it gets pretty bad when anybody from any walk of life says, you know, you're really hitting me right up. and we relegate that to, man, you're really spiritual. No, they were really messy. But then to have the Lord who knows exactly where you're at, exactly, at all times under any situation. That's what you need. Well, you're not going to know the Lord to be able to hear from the Lord unless you have a foundation from the Word. And so, you know, that's why I emphasize, I say, man, hey, there's nothing more important than the beginning. You don't have anything more important than the beginning, which is to spend your time in the Word. There is nothing more important. I saw this early in my walk, and I was blessed to be in a position where I could just relegate my life to the Word for a period of time. And I did it with a vengeance. And I said, you know, because I knew, it didn't take me long, that being around God's people and stuff, there's always something to do. I mean, it didn't take me long to figure that, and I was being pulled and this and that. Oh, there's needs over here, and there's this is going on, and there's that. And I saw, you know, and I was like hidden among all these people, so I wasn't known for anything other than maybe long hair, you know what I mean? But I was like hid, and I went, oh my God, if it's this bad now, I can't imagine when God says you're ready for ministry, how much I'm going to be running, doing this, and maybe not have the time that I really need, that I really want in the Word. And so I said, whoops, and I kind of ducked a little lower so everybody else could be seen above me. And I went, oh boy, I'm going to get in here and I'm going to study and know you. And I saw it and I prayed and I spent time here. And I gave up stuff. I did it. Nobody talked me into it. You shouldn't do this. You shouldn't do this. Don't do it. But I did it because I wanted the Lord. And I have said before, but I am so thankful that I can draw from so much that is here. And God, I can spend, this is the truth, I can open my Bible and spend 2 minutes and go, whoa, man, because the Holy Spirit has all kind of ground to take me to or to remind me of or to show me or whatever. And people that don't, like I said, you know three notes? You know, you like, da-da-da, or da-da-da, or da-da-da. You know what I mean? You know, and after a while, they're like, okay. You know, they're going, well, you're pretty much, give me your repertoire there, old buddy. I'll be off now. You know what I mean? You go, well, wait, maybe I can play it with a little, da-da-da, you know, a little vibrato. Well, all you did was just shake what you already had. and so then we go, well, God, why don't you use me more? You know, I'm available. I see people's spirit all the time. And I see that kind of spirit all the time. I'm available. Why don't you use me? He's going, well, you know, why don't you get in here, get as much of this as you can, and then I will use you. And, you know, Jesus said, pray for laborers. That he's walking with the disciples. He didn't turn them loose right then. He said, pray for laborers. But in the meantime, stick with me for another year and a half of training and teaching and getting in the Word and everything. You see what I mean? He didn't say, laborers are more important. Okay, I'm cutting you guys loose. Okay, I want you over in India. You go to China. You go, you know what I mean? He said, no, y'all stick with me, the Word. Y'all stay with the Word for a little longer here. And then there'll come a time when I can do anything, you know. You know, you may not even know what kind of ministry you're going to do, but does that really matter? It shouldn't matter, because here's the real deal. Are you going to minister the Lord? If you minister in music, is it going to be the Lord? If you minister as a teacher, is it going to be the Lord? If you're just a good counselor that can be there for people, is it the Lord? If you're going to be dealing with youth, is it the Lord? That's the real question. And so this isn't, I need the Lord. I'm knowing the Lord. I have the Lord. You need the Lord see what I mean? A transition begins to go, I have, you know, maybe this can help. You know. But we go,
let's see. Now, I know, basically, I've studied the areas that I'm going to be using. God's just smart enough to take you out of that area. Never open those doors. Just so that you'll fall on your face, get the word, go back in.
I was just thinking, I don't know if this is a little later on, but that Moses went up into the mountain and saw everything up there, and then he came down and all the practical stuff, building it according to what he saw. And I was thinking that a method down here would be like figuring out just how to do this, do that, without having any idea of what you're building according to. So even if it's off, you don't even know that it's off, because you don't know what you're trying to build towards. You don't know the Lord. So it's kind of like if I'm learning chords, I'm just trying to figure out a way to memorize assorted notes instead of understanding the patterns that they came from. Because I understand what the real is, or what I'm building towards.
Right. Well, if you don't know the basic, Jerry's talking about the basic principles. If you don't know the basic principles of the Lord, His nature, flow with the things that are first, you can take notes for years and go back, and those notes will be just a confusing mess. They really don't mean the truth. Or you can get down and say, I want to know the life and spirit behind these things. And then you'll see it in your notes and somebody else's notes. It really does make a difference. I wrote this in mind. You cannot go beyond the beginning. There is nothing that precedes the Word. You can't go back before the beginning. There's nothing that precedes the Word. For you to have a beginning, you must be found in the Word. Found in the Word. Okay? And one way that you can tell that that's working in somebody is when they do spend as much time as they can in the Scriptures. You say, I'd like to do that, but I'm beyond that. We had a class last week that said never leave the beginning. You only take a week. Anytime somebody ever tells you, I got the Word, now I got it, I don't need the Word. You know what I mean? And then they started, I highly got helpless. And when I was in Bible school, I was studying the Word. And I got one of the teachers talked them out of a key to one of the classrooms because the light's out at a certain time. And I got permission to go in that classroom and turn the light on. I pulled it out, all the shades I'd be in there studying. And this guy went out of the hall, he walked in. What are you doing? I'm studying the Word. He said, that's good. I used to do that too, but now I don't need the Word. I said, really? And I was fresh, saying, really? You don't need the Word anymore. What I was saying in the Word is telling me that I couldn't be right, but I don't want to refute somebody who's been in this for like years. I used to really study the Word, but now, man, I have read the Word for years. I don't. He said, how do you see things and stuff? He says, I'll give you an example. The other day I was driving down the road and there was this billboard. And he says, and I really saw the Lord. They killed me. Prayer warrior. But after a while, you know what happens? They slowly begin to fade. fade away. And they're not affected. They'll have flashes of usefulness that are very far apart. And, you know, what I would assume is, since they have flashes very far apart, then we've got a whole lot of time in between after a while once you get put on the show. Again, the what? You know what I'm saying? But a lot of people fall away. They fall away. They go, well, I don't know what the deal is with God, and they don't have answers. They question God. And I'm anointed, and this is where I should be used. You know, I understand prayer better than them, or da-da-da-da, and all this kind of stuff. You know, their attitude shows going on. Why? Because the Word will check you. You know, there have been many a time when, this is the truth, there have been many a time when somebody did something wrong to me, and I'll go, that ain't right, they shouldn't have done that, this and that. And just as clear to my mind, the Word will just come and say, bless those who curse you. And I'll go, bless them, Lord. You know, and in my early days, it was, bless the Lord, you know, and then I would slowly come, but, you know, now it catches me. I go, no, I know exactly what I'm supposed to do. The Word is preeminent over me. Yes, in the beginning is the Word. This is the beginning of this situation with this person. The Word is going to have the preeminence here. I bless them, Lord. I pray for those who despitefully use me. And that's having a foundation on the Word. But if you don't have a foundation on the Word, guess what? You go through 2 weeks, 2 months, or 2 years of being mad at them, trying to figure out how you can get back at them, or, you know, kind of secretly hoping God will really get them, or, you know what I'm saying, something. Because, and we never get right, you know. Well, I had this situation happen to me, and I've been dealing with it for 2 months, you know, and, well, all things work together for good. Yeah, I know that, but, you know, bless God, this should never have happened. All things work together. Oh, yeah. And everything gives back. Yeah, I'm confused. Now, I just really don't understand this. I mean, I cannot get over this. I don't understand this. It ain't right. In everything, thank you, Jesus. But you see what I'm saying? It is, whether you are aware of it or not, you are denying the Word. You just because you don't know it doesn't mean that you're, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you are denying the Word. God, in this country, God gave us all the ability to have a Bible, 2 or 3, 5, 10, different translations. You know, I mean, we are without excuse. You know, the one thing he said, well, what advantage does Israel have? He says, they have the oracles of God. That's the advantage. We have an advantage. You know, and we shouldn't be making excuses. We should say, thank you, Lord, I have this. I know, you know, this is a foundational thing. This is before prayer. Well, should I get the Word or pray? Now, sometimes the Holy Spirit can preempt that because He's God to you. And He can say, pray. But, I mean, if I have a basic choice without any pull in any direction, should I get the Word or pray? Well, I'll go get the Word. Why? In the beginning is the Word. And besides, the Word is God talking to us. Prayer is us talking to God. We need to hear from you more than you need to hear from us. You know what I mean? It's a priority. Jerry?
Yeah, I was just thinking that a lot of times, you know, in the past, I would read things and subjects would change. And because without really understanding,